Good evening. Welcome to the DBS News World for today, Thursday, 22nd August 2019. I'm Kendall Burton. We start with news that the St. Lucia Civil Service Association, or CSA, has taken issue with late salary payments for August 2019 to civil servants by the government of St. Lucia. August salaries of all public servants were expected to be paid on August 22nd. However, due to the just concluded salary negotiations between the government negotiating team and the Trade Union Federation, salary payments were delayed. We learn more from Sheffield Gaylard.
Memes immediately began circulating on social media when civil servants realized that they had not received their August 2019 salaries as expected. According to the government of St. Lucia's salary schedule, salary payments were to be made August 22nd, but that did not happen. Assistant General Secretary of the CSA, Mark Stephen Orbiton, says this was due to the recently concluded negotiations between government and the trade union organizations, which did not give the government sufficient time to process the August salaries using the new payment rates and benefits agreed upon.
We signed day before. Everybody signed the agreement. 30-something, I think, people signed, according to the Labor Department. Okay, so that is done. So the Treasury now had to be given instructions from the government that we have signed, go ahead and prepare the salaries plus retroactive pay. Okay, now retroactive pay, not for CSA alone, you know, talking about thousands of people. My God, the Treasury is made up of the same civil servants. Those persons, I understand, worked all night trying to ensure that all the things are done to get paid today. You know, and I understand some civil servants woke up this morning, go to the bank, our money is not there. And listen to me, today is the 22nd of the month.
Orbiton believes measures should have been put in place early enough to prevent the late payments to public servants.
These civil servants, contrary to what people say outside there, the majority of public servants are hardworking people, you know. People who sacrifice, you know, and work hard. Remember that the public servants over the years had no increases, you know. So when now they have used all the little money, and they don't, what money they get like that, you know, to say, well, okay, they can have big savings, that can go, okay, boy, I can forego a month and go to the bank and get. It's a hand-to-mouth situation. They have school fees to pay for the children, books to buy, things to eat. You know, so when you see the 22nd come, like you say, they're scratching maybe on the 21st, the last $10 to buy the sugar and the cheese for that day, you know, and they're waiting in the morning to go and take that money, maybe to take transport to go to their homes. So I don't blame them for wanting their money on time.
Reliable sources confirmed that August salaries had been completed and processed, and government employees were expected to be paid by Thursday. Attempts to reach the finance department on the matter were unsuccessful. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Meanwhile, Health Minister Senator Mary Isaac says the late signing of the collective agreements between government and the trade unions have resulted in a slight delay in the payment of salaries to civil servants. The collective agreements were signed off on Tuesday, August 20th, 2019. The Finance Department says this left the Accountant General's Department with limited time for the processing to meet the August 22nd pay date. Isaac, a former trade unionist, believes there are lessons to be learned from this latest round of negotiations and the late salary payments. Don Nicholas explains.
Health Minister Senator Mary Isaac, who once sat as president of the St. Lucia Civil Service Association, commended the trade unions for the manner in which negotiations went. This is the first time that negotiations have spanned a six-year period. According to the minister, this does well for the country's fiscal prudence, in that the country can now budget for future increases to public servants.
So let me say my applause goes out to all the unions that negotiated so swiftly and, you know, so effectively, and to bring about an increase in salary for all public workers.
However, the minister lamented the late signing of the collective agreements. They were signed on Tuesday, August 20th, 2019, just 2 days ahead of the August 22nd pay date. This, the minister says, did not allow the Treasury sufficient time to pay civil servants.
However, we were expecting as a government that the trade unions would have signed off by a deadline that they were given so that the Treasury would have been able to pay. They actually moved the deadline so that they can, you know, facilitate signing off by the trade unions. And I believe that it was only yesterday or day before that they signed off and pay as you know, public servants are getting paid today. So how much time have they given the Treasury to process that payment?
The majority of public servants will be paid a lump sum of $1,800, along with salary increases over two trienniums dating back to 2016. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
In other news, one male resident of Jabat East Hill in Miku has been formally charged in connection with the discovery of a quantity of drugs in a barrel on the compound of a local shipping company. The discovery was made on Friday, August 16th, by customs officers attached to the shipping company, who immediately contacted the police. Two individuals were arrested. However, only one was formally charged. Sheffield Gillard has details.
40-year-old Elisha's Charles of Miku was arrested and formally charged after 21 packets of controlled drugs were discovered in a barrel by customs officers. The barrel is believed to have arrived from Canada. Charles was taken to the First District Court on August 19th and was slapped with a number of charges, namely importation of controlled drugs, handling controlled drugs, possession of controlled drugs, and possession with intent to supply controlled drugs. He was bailed in the sum of $18,000, $5,000 on each count, except intent to supply, for which he received bail in the sum of $3,000 cash, suitable surety or land documents. Reporting conditions and travel restrictions have been applied. Elisha's Charles is expected to make a second court appearance on September 26, 2019. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The Substance Abuse Advisory Council Secretariat is hosting a two-day consultation that it hopes will end with agreement on a method to collect data on drug abuse. That data will in turn inform policy decisions directed at reducing drug abuse. Don Nicholas reports.
The Substance Abuse Advisory Council Secretariat is working with stakeholders such as the Borderley Correctional Facility, the National Youth Council, community nurses, the police, and drug-free clubs on a drug information network. The secretariat will be the data bank. Information from the police will take into consideration seizures, quantities, and sentences. The emergency department of the hospital will provide information on drinking and driving, tragic accidents, and the number of persons who were under the influence of alcohol, marijuana, or cocaine. When the information is collated, it can help guide policy decisions and cut down on drug abuse.
It can be used rather to help us influence policy or even change certain things, certain ways that we plan and other measures that we can actually take to improve what is happening in St. Lucia.
The data will also indicate what sectors in society are the most affected by substance abuse and which substances are the most widely used. Also, the council would be able to determine whether there are any new substances being introduced to St. Lucia.
Also, we will get to know from this movement other synthetic drugs or new drugs that are actually creeping in that other island states or the wider countries would have had, and St. Lucia is not exposed just yet, and other information that relates to substance abuse and its management. All of these things will be able to pull out from this two-day workshop.
Consultants are working with the secretariat in facilitating the workshop. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Don Nicholas, and this is Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
Why the government have the courthouse by two bars?
St. Lucians, Jesus is alive, and he's calling us to repent. Not only do we have to repent, but we have to do the things that are pleasing to others, to live for ourselves and for others.
I live up Lackley, and then the health center opening, I think is 8 o'clock or 8:30. Sometime I walk in 6 o'clock or before six, and there is people there, sitting there waiting. That time the doctors are still sleeping. They're waiting to get a chance to get to the doctor, because when it's 12 o'clock, the doctor gone and they don't have time to see the doctor. That does hurt my heart. So I am saying, praise the Lord. I getting a little retirement so I can go to a private doctor, because it's really bad to see the amount of elderly standing up, waiting to see the doctor. Do you think that is fair?
I have an issue with the bus drivers. I'm not vexed or anything, but I want to know if they have like an independent body that is there to inspect the buses, the condition of the buses. But bus drivers make a lot of money, you know. And then sometimes the AC not working, the window stick, the seat dirty in your clothes, you see that piece of iron juking in your back. You know, and we have to open the door. What about that? Places like Trinidad, I travel a lot. Trinidad, St. Vincent, they have a conductor sitting by the door. You know, if I'm closing the door, give me a discount. I pay half price, but I'm working for you now. You know, and the last time I had experience, I go to a bus in my nice white t-shirt, and I went down the bus. My shirt have a big stain from the seat. So I'm telling the driver that, the driver I'm taking me on. Like, you know, like, I have wrong. And I still have to pay him $2 for ruining my new t-shirt. You know, so I don't know if they have any association or anything that could inspect these buses, make sure they fit to carry the passengers, you know. It's not just about the money, you have to treat us nice and, you know, make us feel comfortable. And the AC, oh my God, I don't know when else I get AC on the bus. And the bus have AC for the passengers, right? Rain falling and you have to be sweaty, you have to open the window, you're getting wet. And the driver's not on the AC, you know. And when they have two tourists on board, oh, AC blowing. The glass fog up with AC, fog. But when it's the everyday passengers, you know, we get no special treatment, but the tourists, you know, hey, tourists.
This has been Street Vibes with me, Don Nicholas. We now take you back to the studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader. You can listen to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and The Wave 94.5 and 93.7 FM. We're also on the web and streaming live on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Coming up, the Home Affairs Minister reports a 9% decline in serious crime and the Ministry of Agriculture working to reduce the food import bill. Welcome back. National Security Minister Hermenegild Francis has confirmed that serious crimes are down by 9% this year as compared to the same period in 2018. The minister made the announcement ahead of Thursday's sitting of the Senate. He also gave an update on the police officer who was injured in Wednesday's accident on the John Compton Highway. Don Nicholas has details.
In announcing measures to combat crime, National Security Minister Senator Hermenegild Francis says in the very near future, CCTV cameras will be installed in Castries and Vifort. The minister added that more officers are patrolling crime hotspots on foot, and this, he says, is working well. Since the deployment of the additional officers, there has been a decrease in house break-ins and other serious crimes, 9% to be precise.
There is a 10%, I think it's an 8 or 9% decrease in serious crimes like house break-in and assaults and so on. So we have had this team out there doing extra patrols. Now we have given the police the authority to recruit 40 more officers. 20 are going to be in Castries, 10 in Vifort, 10 in Soufre. So it is working.
Minister Francis also spoke about a vehicular collision on Wednesday on the John Compton Highway near Jean-Marie's gas station, which left a police officer injured. The officer has since been transferred from the Victoria Hospital to the Tapio Medical Facility. Minister Francis highlighted the importance of insurance coverage for police officers and other government employees.
Yesterday, I think that the President Chico gave a very good interview, and the insurance that the government has now put in place actually kicked in. And they were able to transfer the guy from VH straight to Tapio. And I think everybody's happy about that.
The National Security Minister says government is committed to providing the resources for the police force to execute its duties. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The Ministry of Agriculture will soon be implementing an import substitution program for a range of crops in an effort to not only reduce the island's food import bill, but to assist local farmers focus on what they can grow on a sustainable basis. According to Agriculture Minister Ezekiel Joseph, St. Lucia imports over $7 million of traditional crops on a yearly basis. And if local farmers can be consistent in the production of these crops, the island's food importation bill could be reduced significantly. Sheffield Gillard explains.
Erratic forms of production not only haven't been good for farmers' business, but saddled government with a multi-million dollar food bill from having to import food that, in many cases, can be produced locally. Agriculture Minister Ezekiel Joseph says a desire to address issues with consistency and other production challenges have made an import substitution program a necessity.
The vegetable import substitution program is not there to compete with our local production. What we are targeting is the importation. And let me give you some figures. When we analyze the 2017 figures, as far as trade of what we call our traditional crops, the figure shows that between the hotels and the supermarket, the trade figures was $3.7 million, traditional crops. $3.7 million in local market. But yet still, the importation of the seven crops you're looking at was $4.9 million. So what that's telling us? That is telling us as a country, that is telling us as a ministry, that there are opportunities for our farmers. Because our importation figures for the seven crops, not the entire traditional crop, for the seven crops, is much higher than what we are trading locally.
With the help and support of the government of Taiwan, the government has decided to bite the bullet and see what can be done about the situation. The crops identified are tomatoes, lettuce, sweet pepper, cantaloupes, cabbage, pineapple, and watermelon.
We believe that if we implement that project successfully, we can see a dent in the importation of these crops. And I have the fullest confidence working with my farmers, and of course, and I smile when I say that, the extension officers, we should be able to see the impact of our programs as it pertains to the import substitution program.
The government of Taiwan has approved a three-year project. However, a commencement date has not been agreed upon. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The negative effect of climate change on local farmers was highlighted at Massey Store's annual registered farmers meeting yesterday, held under the theme Engaging and Sharing on Sustainable Agriculture. The Agriculture Minister Ezekiel Joseph urged farmers to get crop insurance to safeguard against disasters. The meeting also updated local farmers on the successes and challenges of Massey's registered farmers program, local produce sales, customer buying patterns, market trends, and new developments. Sheffield Gillard has more.
Addressing the hundreds of farmers in attendance, Agriculture Minister Ezekiel Joseph reminded the gathering that the biggest challenge is not pests or diseases, but climate change. He spoke to farmers about how they can help build a more resilient agriculture sector. The island's agriculture sector has been hit by several storms over the last years, severely impacting production levels. As a result, Minister Joseph urged the farmers to get crop insurance, which will assist with the post-disaster recovery.
That is why we are encouraging our farmers to look at the whole aspect of insurance. Those of us who have been involved in banana production, of course, knows about windcrop. Windcrop has outlived its usefulness. Windcrop was only looking at banana farmers and it's only looking at wind damage. But now every aspect of climate change affects agriculture. Heavy rains affect agriculture. Heavy temperature affect agriculture. Wind affect agriculture. So it's not only the whole aspect of, we should not be focusing on one crop and we should not be focusing on only one period. So we have been encouraging our farmers to work along with EC Global, what they call the Livelihood Protection Program, where they can at least create some safety net as it pertains to the negative impact of climate change.
The annual farmers meeting is one of Massey Store's major engagement sessions with farmers from all sectors.
We meet with a wide cross section of the farming community today to show them how well we did, Also, we are seeking information from them on what are the challenges. We are going to tell them some of the areas we think we did really well and some of the other opportunities we are seeing. You know, plus we will also, like I said earlier, hear what are the challenges, because it's a dynamic sector that doesn't remain the same. A lot of things change, so we have to always meet with them.
Farmers had opportunities to win prizes and get information on some of the latest agricultural inputs available from partners such as Renwick and Company, who was also in attendance. Wednesday's meeting was held at the Financial Administrative Center at Point Serafin. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
When the DBS News World continues, young people warned about the dangers of social media. Government is in the process of setting up a new commission to review the minimum wage. The issue came up in light of the review of the Child Maintenance Act, with special emphasis on child maintenance fees. Some have argued that current fees are too small to meet the average child's basic needs. Don Nicholas filed this report.
Government Senator Fortuna Bello says the whole society needs to lobby against the $250 per month child maintenance fee. But she noted there is still a high level of unemployment. In the past, the extended family made up for the shortfall of unemployed fathers. Also, financial circumstances vary from father to father. But the government senator says there must be a standard to measure the cost of child maintenance,
so that people are not just looked at and determined, well, you have money and you should be paying more and you should be paying more. There should be a measuring stick. And of course, we have to ensure that we get to this point. But I think the key thing is to be in an environment where our citizens understand that they have an obligation when they have a child, and they have to do whatever they can to ensure that they maintain and meet the commitments with respect to the development of the children.
Like Social Justice Minister Leonard Motoot pointed out on Tuesday, incarcerating unemployed fathers will do more harm than good. Senator Belrose agrees with these sentiments. But apart from those who are unemployed, there are persons who earn just a tad above the $250 child maintenance fee per fortnight. This raises serious questions about the minimum wage. There are suggestions that it should be placed at $900 per month.
Well, I don't know. That's for the experts to work on. I'm not an expert around labor relations, labor laws, and labor movement. But I think the important thing is that it's on our agenda, and of course, we're handling it. And I think the Minister of Labor is quite capable of working with his team to ensure that the country realizes something that is impactful for it.
Senator Belrose spoke to reporters just before the commencement of Thursday's sitting of the Senate. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The Minister for External Affairs and Castries Central MP Sarah Flood Bobra is cautioning the public, young people especially, about the disastrous consequences of posting unsavory images of themselves on social media. The minister warned that this can ruin their employment chances or other opportunities in life. Once again, here's Don Nicholas.
Minister for External Affairs and Castries Central MP Sarah Flood Bobra has observed a tendency for some young people to post pictures of themselves on the social media scantily dressed. This, the minister warns, does not portray a good image. And the minister warns that this could get the attention of potential employers who are turned off by such images.
When I want to share that post to an employer that you're asking me to recommend you to, I can't share a post with you bareback or with you with a spliff in your mouth. So I ask them to take it down, please, because I want to recommend you. And that's the only thing the person has to assess you by. And that person may form a wrong impression about you because of just one picture, which would be unfortunate.
Young people may be inclined to post those unsavory images while having fun. But in keeping with the adage that after joy comes sorrow, these images can cause irreparable damage to their reputation.
Sometimes a friend, well-intentioned, may post a party that you're at, and well-intentioned having fun, that might get into the wrong place. And what do you do afterwards? You can't take it back. So the advice is for us all to be careful about our use of social media, the things we do to have fun that might look like fun but might actually be unhealthy, and one bad decision can cost us dearly, especially in the world we live in. So this is just a comment that I want to make, a caution, just to young people. I say this to my children as well.
The parliamentary representative made the comments just before Tuesday's parliament session. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Stay tuned. The DBS News World will continue in a moment.
Good evening. Welcome to the DBS Sports. We bounce off with news on basketball. Basketball for the Future chalked up yet another victory, this time over Denry Dolphins, 84-43 in the final game of the regular season in the National League Basketball. The wins confirmed the top two spot in Group B. The hot hands for Basketball for the Future were top scorer Craig Duplessis with 17 points and Ron DeMerville with 14 points, 4 rebounds, 4 steals and 3 assists. Denry's shooting and poor defensive showing played a major part in their dismal performance. The team finished the season with a 1-2 record, good enough to keep them in the third place spot in Group B. Contributors for the Dolphins were Peter Hunt with 10 points, 6 rebounds, 6 steals, Donnelly Joseph 9 points, 4 steals, and Claude Bissett 6 points, 5 rebounds. The teams playing in Friday's semifinals are Mont Gladiators. They take on the Combined Schools, and Basketball for the Future, they take on Bonte Blazers. The first game bounces off at 6:30 p.m. The finals will be played on Saturday, August 24th at the Postage Indoor Practice Facility, and game time is 7 p.m. In football, St. Lucia opened their campaign in the CONCACAF Under-17 Girls Qualifiers with a hard-fought 2-1 victory against Anguilla on Wednesday, 21st August in Honduras. Both of St. Lucia's goals were scored by their captain, Christian St. Louis. The teams ended the first half goalless. St. Lucia's next encounter is against Honduras, the host, on Friday 23rd. In the group match played, Honduras really thrashed Bonaire 12-0. The halftime score was 3-0. The winner of the group advances to the next round in 2020. Another round of matches was played in the St. Lucia Football Association Inc. National Lotteries Authority Island Cup last evening. In the first of a doubleheader played at the Marshall Grounds, Grosley overcame a 2-goal deficit to draw their encounter with Miku 2-2. Miku had enjoyed a 2-0 cushion at the end of the first half with goals from Rai, Gasper and Shane Paul. However, Grosley stormed back in the second half and were rewarded with 2 penalties, which were successfully converted by Tev Lawrence. In the second match of the night, Marsha, the home team, they early edged out Marbella Valley 1-0 with a goal by Johnny Lesmore. At the Francois playing field, Larry were lit turned up 46 minutes late for their encounter against Rosa Valley, presenting the referee with no alternative but to call off the game. In the second game played, Central Castries were defeated Barbano 4-2. The halftime score was 2-0 in favour of Central Castries. Silly news on football, the regional Lashley Charity Youth Cup being played in Grenada. The Grosley and the 17 football team defeated Just Sports of Grenada 2-1. Both goals were scored by Jalil Joseph. Though the team ended their campaign with 7 points in the 5-team group, 2 wins, a draw and a loss, this was insufficient for them to advance to the next round. Meanwhile, another St. Lucian football team playing over in Grenada enjoyed mixed results. The boys' training centre in their historic overseas football engagement defeated Creeks of Trinidad and Tobago 3-1, and that game was played on Monday, but went down to Assoms of Grenada 3-0 on Tuesday. However, yesterday they bounced back to defeat Morvant Element of Trinidad and Tobago 3-1. The fourth edition of the Q Sports St. Lucia Inc. Classic Pool Tournament, sponsored by Lucelec, St. Lucia National Lotteries Authority, Sean Reckon Garage Service, Gemini Impressions and participating venues continues this weekend with 4 matches. Wolfpack of VA4 will come up against Len Outers of Miku, and Cool Shooters of VA4 will face Rainbow Lasers of Grand Riviere Grosley on Friday 23rd at Skip's Pub in Castries. While on Saturday 24th, Len Outers of Miku will square off with Cool Shooters of VA4, and Young Generations of VA4 will take on Rainbow Blazers of Grand Riviere Grosley at People's Pub in V4. last Friday, 16th of August, at Harrow's Taylor Plus in VA4. Two matches were played. Cool Shooters of VA4 defeated the Wolfpack, also of VA4, 4-1, while Charlie's Bar of VA4 outplayed Young Generation, also of VA4, 4-2. In cricket, the long-awaited final of the St. Lucia National Cricket Association Alistair John T20 Women's Competition will be played this coming Saturday at the Minute for the Park. The game will be played between Grosley Ladies and South Castries Females. South Castries are the defending champions. The game will bowl off from 2 p.m. and the competition named after Miss Alistair John. Miss Alistair John will be on hand to meet the teams before the game commences. Well, before we go to break, our Oh My Goodness segment.
4.5 days.
Oh!
Titty.
Oh! For a long way.
4.5 days.
Oh!
Titty.
Oh! For a long way.
4.5 days.
Oh!
Titty.
Oh! For a long way.
4.5 days.
Oh!
Titty.
Oh! For a long way.
Oh my goodness. Stay tuned. More sports after the break. Thank you for staying tuned. We should have news on netball. The St. Lucia Netball Association, following a meeting with its affiliates and various stakeholders, is continuing with its efforts to strengthen the capacity and deliver good governance. To this end, a task force of the Constitution Review Committee, under the chairmanship of Karen Tobier, has been charged with the responsibility of paving the way forward in streamlining the Constitution to meet the growing demands and changes of the sport. This is a very important exercise, and as such, the committee would like to meet with all and sundry on a day and time convenient in an effort to solicit their views and entertain inputs. In cricket, further afield, England will make a break from tradition by staging the opening test of their 2020 home season at the Oval. The England and Wales Cricket Board released the international fixtures for next season yesterday with a packed programme featuring visits by West Indies, Australia, Pakistan and Ireland. The Oval, the South London headquarters of Surrey, usually hosts the last test of an English season, but in 2020, it will launch the programme instead. With the first test starting on June 4th, it should mean England's leading players will be available to take part in the bulk of next year's Indian Premier League 2020 franchise competition. After the Oval, England will face the West Indies in tests at Edgbaston and Lord's. England will also play three tests against Pakistan at Lord's, Old Trafford and Trent Bridge. Both the West Indies and Pakistan series will count towards the World Test Championship table. Meanwhile, on day one of the third Ashes Test at Headingley, where rain and bad light limited play, Australia slipped from 136-2 to 179 all out. Jofra Archer bagged 6-45 in just his second test. For Australia, Labuschagne 74 and Warner 61 were the main scorers. And just a reminder that West Indies are also taking on India in the first test of a two-test series and will have the one end of the scores in tomorrow's sportscast. And finally, tonight in news on tennis, well, Serena Williams will play Maria Sharapova in the first round of the U.S. Open at Flushing Meadows in New York. 2018 women's champion Naomi Osaka plays Anna Blinkova of Russia, while 15-year-old Coco Gauff, who beat Venus Williams on her way to reaching the fourth round at Wimbledon last month, will play Russia's Anastasia Potapova. Meanwhile, Wimbledon champion Simona Halep will take on a qualifier, while Britain's Joanna Konta faces Daria Kasatkina of Russia. Novak Djokovic begins his title in a men's draw against Spaniard Roberto Carvalho Baena. Elsewhere in the men's draw, Spain's Rafael Nadal will play Australian John Millman, while 20-time Grand Slam champion Roger Federer will face a qualifier. Britain's Kyle Edmund will play Spain's Pablo Andujar, while Dan Evans faces Adrian Mannarino of France, while Cameron Norrie will take on a qualifier. Wow, what a mouthful. Now with our thought to take you through the night. 8 things to remember when going through tough times. 1, everything can and will change. 2, you have overcome challenges before. 3, it's a learning experience. 4, not getting what you want can be a blessing. 5, allow yourself to have some fun. 6, being kind to yourself is the best medicine. 7, other people's negativity isn't worth worrying about. And 8, and there's always, always, always something to be thankful for. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
On the lighter side tonight, a Massachusetts police department shared video of an officer rescuing a skunk with a yogurt cup stuck on its head and being sprayed as his reward. The Cambridge Police Department's video shows Officer McGinty approaching the skunk and plucking the yogurt cup off the animal's head. The panicked skunk then sprayed McGinty as a stinky punishment. Special shout out to our fleet maintenance crew too, as they had to tackle the de-skunking of Officer McGinty's vehicle, the department said on a social media post. That's the DBS News World for today, Thursday. I'm Kendall Burton. On behalf of the entire news team, thank you so much for watching. Good evening.